A great German theologian often referred to Jesus' parables as God's picture book. And last Sunday, it closed on a very high note with that wonderful picture of amazing grace that we saw in the parable of the prodigal son. I hope we went home encouraged by the robe and the ring placed on the wayward young man by his unconditionally loving father. And I hope we felt somewhere deep inside that if there was a home for the prodigal, then there's a home for us too. The parables do come alive for us when we begin to see ourselves in them. And we say to ourselves, that's me. Depending on where we are in life, we are the prodigal or maybe the older brother who can't stand for God to do so much for other people and not enough for me. Or maybe we're the suffering parent who agonizes with a child through his mistakes. But now we've come to this Sunday, the week before Holy Week, and we find Jesus teaching in the temple just a few days before the triumphal entry, which we observe next week on Palm Sunday. But this time, Jesus' parable doesn't end with everything turning out pretty well. There's something darker and more sinister in the gospel today, something that might cause us to look in the mirror and ask, wonder, could that be me? Luke has moved a long way in his gospel from the time of last Sunday's parable. In the days of Jesus and his disciples eating and drinking and teaching and healing by the lakeside are past. On his long journey up to Jerusalem, we see a much more solemn, austere Jesus who understands more and more that the party is over and yet continues to walk day after day after day, soberly, with intention, going up to Jerusalem for the Passover. Now there's little mingling with the crowds, and only four healings, and his words seem more harsh and angry. Luke writes, one day as he was teaching the people in the temple and preaching the gospel, the chief priests and the scribes with the elders came up and said to him, tell us by what authority you do these things, or who it is that gave you that authority. But Jesus challenged them with a question about the baptism of John the Baptist, which no matter how they answered it, would make them look bad in the eyes of the people. So they refused to answer. And so Jesus didn't answer either. At that point, Jesus begins our parable for today, telling it to the people, but against the scribes and the chief priests. He tells of a man who planted a vineyard, let it out to tenants, and went away. Very common thing. At the time for the harvest, he sent a servant to collect some of the fruit. But the servants beat him and sent him away, empty-handed. Another servant they beat treated shamefully and sent away empty-handed. Still another servant came, and this time they wounded him and cast him out of the vineyard. Again and again, think about it, again and again, the Father had sent prophets calling his people to repent and to produce good fruit. And those prophets have not been well received, nor were they heeded. Now the repeated offers of the vineyard owner all through history of the Jewish nation were culminating in a final offering. The Father, this time, is sending his Son. Would the heir be respected? Unlike the prophets that were sent before? No. Would he be brutally murdered? Yes. Would it seem like the wicked tenants had been successful? Yes. And suddenly it begins to dawn on us, as we think about this, that maybe we're in this too somewhere. Like maybe we were in the parable of the prodigal son somewhere. Maybe we haven't mugged a rent collector or murdered the owner's son or plotted a hostile takeover or anything like that. But we, like the vineyard terrorists, have, in the words of a famous prayer familiar to us all, I hope, followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts, offended against thy holy laws, left undone those things which we ought to have done, and done those things which we ought not to have done. In some ways, we're really not all that different from the tenants in the vineyard. And now, following all the prophets, the Father has sent his Son, and the Son of God has been crucified. Wow. The Son of God has been crucified. What happens now? Easter happens. The vineyard owner does not come to destroy, but to resurrect. He doesn't come to retaliate, he comes to redeem. Our future is in his hand. Trust him in spite of all the appearances to the contrary. God is in charge. God reigns. And Jesus is the risen Lord who calls us to be people of a new covenant. The temple will be destroyed. The new people of God emerge through Jesus' resurrection. But how could we be so sure that God reigns, especially when so much of life seems to whittle down our faith? I may be simplistic, but the answer I give is come and see. Come and experience. Come and drink deeply of the Paschal mystery, revealed so powerfully in the next few weeks of the church year. I know most of us are very busy. I know that. And there will always be any number of things clamoring for our time and for our attention. But we are now coming to the heart and core of our Christian faith. And I really do challenge you, not to allow anything to get in the way, to make a commitment, perhaps to the Stations of the Cross this Friday. Be here next Sunday for Jesus' entry into Jerusalem and for the first reading of the Passion. Be present Maundy Thursday, the evening when our Lord gave us the Blessed Sacrament of his body and blood. And resist all temptations not to be present as we ponder Jesus' sacrificial love for us in his suffering and dying for us on the cross. And finally, although for some of you, Saturday night may seem like a really odd time for worship, especially when you plan on attending anyhow on Easter morning. But the Easter Vigil has become, for many people, the greatest and most meaningful worship of the entire year. I've been doing it for over 60 years, and I wouldn't think of being anywhere else, no matter what was going on, if I wasn't at the Easter Vigil. The owner of the vineyard does not come to destroy, but to resurrect. He hasn't come to retaliate, but to redeem. We're set free knowing that if Easter were about retribution, the world would have been vaporized on the third day, not saved. Never forget, no matter how far down the scale of doubt and despair we may have gone, Christ is risen, and in him we have eternal life. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the